So with your permission, we start the proceedings of this very important, crucial and topical webinar. We have the distinguished presence of the Honorable Minister, Shri Jai Pratap Singh Ji, who is the Cabinet Minister, Medical and Health, Family Welfare, Maternal and Child Welfare Department, Uttar Pradesh. He is our chief guest. And we have Dr. Naresh Trehan as our guest of honor, as also Mr. Mukesh Meshram of the Indian Administrative Service, Commissioner, Lucknow Zone, Uttar Pradesh, and Mr. Rajat Banerjee, Head Corporate Affairs, Amway India Enterprises. But we also have someone from the field of journalism, a very, very eminent known name, Mr. Sudhir Mishra, who is the editor of Navbharat Times. And we have a distinguished presence from the Indo-American Chamber of Commerce Executive Director from Greater Houston, Mr. Jagdeep Aluwalia. But last but not the least, the webinar would be incomplete if we did not have the distinguished and gracious presence of Dr. Preeta Rajaraman, PhD. She is the health attaché and regional representative, US Embassy, New Delhi. And we also have the presence of our former chairman of UP branch of Indo-American Chamber of Commerce, Mr. Ehsan Khan, based in Varanasi. And it is our privilege to have our national president, Mrs. Rajyalakshmi Rao, who is taking so much of keen interest, you see, in the webinars which are taking place all over the country under the auspices of the Indo-American Chamber of Commerce. So we are grateful to her for taking out time to participate in this very important seminar. We also have the distinguished presence of Mr. Mukesh Bahadur Singh, who is responsible for convening this seminar, and he is the convener for this. As also, I thank our secretariat headed by Ms. Kashish Tyagi, who has been responsible for organizing the speakers also and getting in touch with them and putting us in touch with each other. So with this and with your permission, we would start the proceedings. It was very heartening to see the report as it appeared in today's newspapers, the Finance Ministry's report, that India has flattened the COVID-19 curve because of the effective containment measures taken by the central government as well as the state governments, and particularly the state of Uttar Pradesh. So if the curve has flattened, it means, in terms of what the Prime Minister said, that economy is showing signs, is showing green shoots as the country emerges from the coronavirus lockdown. He's emphasized on the focus both on life and livelihood. That is where healthcare comes in. And we have such eminent people to speak on that today, like private players, you see, headed by Medanta, headed by Dr. Naresh Trehan, who are playing a great role as private players in the control of coronavirus and also in the treatment thereof. And we also have the U.S. participation through Houston. It is very important for the U.S. companies, particularly those who are members of the Indo-American Chamber of Commerce, to take effective steps with the state government of Uttar Pradesh to promote better health care in the state, as also, of course, in the country. And the US companies have a great role to play, and that is where the role of the Indo-American Chamber of Commerce comes handy. Everything will not be possible unless there is a support of the US government and the US embassy in these initiatives. And it has been our pleasant experience during the last decades, that the US embassy has always extended great cooperation to us. And today we have one of the top embassy officials, Dr. Preeta Rajaraman, to participate in this webinar as our guest of honor. Now, with these initial opening remarks, I would request our national president, Mrs. Rajyalakshmi Rao, to please give her address. But I would request all the speakers to please maintain the time limits, not to exceed those, because we are very keen to hear the Honorable Minister of State of Uttar Pradesh to tell us what is this government in Uttar Pradesh trying to do to control and contain the coronavirus. Over to you, Mrs. Rajyalakshmi Rao.
Thank you, Lalit. It gives me immense pleasure to extend a warm and cordial welcome to all of you on behalf of Indo-American Chamber of Commerce on impact of COVID and healthcare sector dialogue. We have the best people today in this webinar, and we're welcoming our chief guest, Shri Jai Pratap Singh Ji, Honorable Cabinet Minister, Medical and Health Care UP, and our guest of honor, Dr. Preeta Rajaraman, Health Attaché and Regional Representative of US Embassy, New Delhi, Mr. Mukesh Meshram, Commissioner Lucknow, and a special keynote address by none other than Dr. Naresh Trehan, MD Medanta, who doesn't know him? And the speakers, Mr. Rajat Banerjee and Mr. Sudhir Maestri, our own ISCC extension in Houston, Mr. Jagdeep Ahluwalia, and we have with us Mr. Mukesh Singh from Lucknow, and Ehsan Khan, our EC member and past chairman of Varanasi, and members and guests who are all present here listening to us. The best thing that has happened to us is 100% FDI is allowed under the automatic route in healthcare. And in this sector, it has been done for both brownfield and greenfield. Ayushman Bharat has also come up with a lot of schemes, insurance cover, and also to establish hospitals in tier 2 and 3 cities, and relaxation of taxes on hospitals in these cities for first 5 years. These are the latest developments coming from the central government. And of course, UP is in the forefront looking after everything. And incentivizing wellness seeking behavior in Poshan Abhiyan to eliminate the malaise of malnutrition, and Prime Minister's call for Fit India movement. These are the things which government has come up with, and Ayushman Bharat itself will look after 10 crore poor and vulnerable families, giving them insurance up to 5 lakhs. And these are the wonderful things that Prime Minister has come up with. We have in Indo-American Chamber of Commerce, where do we play a role in this? We have been there since almost 52 years. And we're the only bilateral chamber having started so far back. And we have branches across the country, and members from India and US companies. And these branches we have are in Mumbai, Kolkata, Delhi, Varanasi, Ahmedabad, Bangalore, Chennai, Hyderabad, and Pune. And we're extending still. The most important thing is we are like catalysts. Anybody wants to do anything in India from US, we are the perfect people, perfect scenario, and we will hold their hand, whoever has any fear of coming in, along with the government, along with whoever wants to take our help. So that is the role we are playing in various sectors. And right now, health system is what the whole world is looking at. Every day, we're only looking at health system, what's happening to us, because we're all locked in. And to get this out, I think the entire health sector industry, doctors, nurses, and all the paramedical officers, everybody is putting together their might and their health and their life itself to help all of us. So this is a very important issue to discuss. And I'm so happy our regional president, Dr. Lalit Basin, our eminent Supreme Court advocate, and also chairman of Bar Association of India, and besides a good friend, and has taken up a very good cause and brought in the best people to speak on this. So I think I have to just keep quiet and let everybody speak, except that to say that UP is doing fantastic job. And I must say, I must compliment your entire ministry for taking up a lot of new initiatives and the new ordinances for labor laws and various things. And I think your chief minister is doing awesome work. And thank you very much, Honorable Minister Ji, for having come into this webinar to talk to us. With these words, I thank you all for giving me the opportunity.
Thank you, Madam President. Thank you for your opening remarks. And now it is my pleasant task to request a very senior member of our Executive Council, that is Mr. Ehsan Khan, who heads Ehsan Exports and is based in the Prime Minister's constituency, that is Varanasi. So over to you, Mr. Ehsan Khan.
Thank you very much, and thank you very much, everyone. Thank you very much for inviting me this August gathering, especially when you have the minister here, the Namaskar Minister Sahab, and Dr. Naresh Trehan, of course, as Mrs. Rao said, who doesn't know him, and we all look forward to what he has to say. Ms. Rajaraman, welcome to the meeting, and I am eagerly looking forward to what you and Mr. Ahluwalia and all the others have to say to us. I will not be taking up much of your time, but I'm looking forward to an enlightening talk, or the, you know, whatever you have to say, because people like us who are here are really scared. We don't know what's going to happen, and nobody knows what's going to happen. So I guess that's why nobody's telling us what's going to happen. We're just scared, and we are all looking forward to something positive happening. I would like to request Mantri Ji to please, for UP, we must, I'm taking this opportunity to say it now, maybe I don't get the chance later, that home quarantine is not allowed in UP, somehow or the other. If that is allowed, probably we will see an increase in the compliance for voluntary testing, and it will curb the hospitalization process. Dr. Trehan can guide us much better on that, because in Delhi, they are doing fantastic work with the home quarantine that has reduced the load of asymptomatic people in the hospital. I mean, people are really scared. Where we only have two organizations here, two hospitals in Varanasi, where we are supposed to go, and God forbid if there's a case of an asymptomatic person being detected, he doesn't know what to do, because he doesn't want to go to the hospital. It is not exactly a very pleasant place to be at the moment. So this is just a request that I had. I thought I'll take the opportunity to request Jai Pratap Singh Ji. He has done a remarkable work here in Uttar Pradesh. Dr. Trehan, of course, his hospital is leading the show in Lucknow. And we in Varanasi also, we have tried to work out things that the administration has been working very well. But as I said in the beginning, we are really scared. We don't know what's going to happen, how long it's going to happen. Nobody knows how long. But yes, we are all eagerly looking forward to some breakthroughs coming through, and a lot of people working on it. And let's see how it moves forward from there. Thank you very much again, Dr. Basin Sahab, for allowing me to speak a little bit. And I look forward to hearing from whatever everybody else has to say. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Ehsan Khan. You said that something positive should be happening, except that no one should test positive, you see, these days. Positive is not the correct word, if I may say so. But thanks a lot for your very, very positive remarks. And now it is my pleasure to have our guest of honor, Mr. Mukesh Meshram from the Indian Administrative Service. He is of the 1995 batch and hails originally from Balaghat, Madhya Pradesh, and was allocated to the Uttar Pradesh cadre. He is presently posted as Commissioner at Lucknow, a very important position. So we are indeed privileged to have the presence of Mr. Mukesh Meshram, and I request him to please give his remarks and address. Mr. Mukesh Ram.
I think sir, Mukesh Meshram sir disconnect ho gaye, tab tak aap next speaker par jayega.
Theek hai. Okay. Thank you, Mukesh ji, for telling us. So now it is my pleasure to have to request Mr. Rajat Banerjee. Mr. Rajat Banerjee is Head Corporate Affairs of Amway. I think all of us have heard about Amway, Amway India Enterprises. He is the Vice President Corporate Affairs at Amway. And prior to joining Amway, he was a journalist for 8 years in Delhi, working with Statesman, and 5 years with Down to Earth, a publication from the Center for Science and Environment. He started his career when he worked in tea and coffee estates in Munnar, Coorg, and Tirunelveli for Tata Tea and BBTC. So welcome to you, Mr. Rajat Banerjee. We look forward to your address.
Thank you, and very warm good afternoon to all on this webinar, especially Minister Jai Pratap Singh ji. And it's a very very heavy top heavy kind of a panel, and I'm privileged to speak before everyone. And I do apologize if I may deviate a bit. And just by way of quick background, as you all might be aware, Amway is into nutraceuticals, that is supplements. I shall not be talking much about Amway, as I promised Kashish. It'll be a very generic kind of a presentation. The speakers before me have made a passing reference to COVID and where things stand. And I think we are all quite update as to where we really lie, I mean, and how much what the situation really is. But what is really coming out very, very strongly, if you look at the healthcare systems across the world, the healthcare systems are stretched. And to a very large extent, I think it's incumbent on the individual to really look after herself or himself. And I think to a large extent, that is where something like supplementation and maybe in our context, Ayurveda also comes in. Of course, if it's proven. If it's something that's not proven, I don't think we can really jump into it. So that is where we come in. And again, what we've seen to a large extent, even here in Delhi, in Gurgaon, you know, turning to the medical system as such is not always been the most pleasant of experiences for a variety of reasons. The medical fraternity is stretched. We are seeing some very, very, you know, heartrending messages out there on Facebook, etc. I saw something from Bangalore today, all across the country. It's really, really very difficult. So I think in a certain way, it's, you know, back to self-care to a large extent for the majority of the people. And here is where, like I did mention, you know, immunity boosters play a big, big role. And words like supplements, minerals, vitamins are no longer restricted to something like the swish crowd, which is coming out of a gym, or which is part of a, you know, a high-end cycling or a running club as such. It is something that is really, you know, your health in your hands, and what can you be doing to keep yourself healthy in this kind of a time. Of course, we all know that, you know, a balanced diet itself should suffice. But the reality is that, you know, as so many reports and, you know, studies tell us from time to time. Our diets may not be able to really give us our adequate number of quantities of minerals, fatty acids, phytochemicals, etc., which kind of fortifies the body to, you know, to take on various situations like the one we're going through right now. So a bit on supplementation. In the Indian context, we have, you know, traditional herbs to boost the immunity. Some of them are doing reasonably well. And like I said, some of them might be kind of jumping the gun in terms of entering the market and spoiling, or rather bespoiling, the situation, which is not really required, because any traditional form of healthcare, of medicine, is very strong, is very deep, and with just the right amount of, you know, scientific tempering and evidence-based products, we can really, you know, set a good space for ourselves. If you look at the Indian, and again, sorry to speak like a marketer, but that's where I would really, you know, step in as, if you look at the dietary supplement or the herbal medicine market in the Indian context, it ranges around the $3.5 billion in 2018, and it could go up to $4.4 billion in 2023. Assuming that the middle classes are, you know, have the capacity and they grow as planned, this represents a promising kind of a market as such for players in supplementation, etc. And as I did mention, this would include not just the modern dietary supplements where Amway and companies like Amway and Herbalife, etc., would come into the play, but as well as the traditional Indian Ayurvedic systems. Speaking as from the nutraceutical perspective, our products are all governed under FSSAI, under the food laws, because we come in as a food supplement. And as we all know, the standards as outlined by FSSAI are fairly strong. These would include nutraceuticals, food for special dietary needs, and food for special medical purposes. So, of course, none of our products, we can really put out a strong medical claim. The fact remains that these do assist us in our fundamental approach as such. Well, is it all, you know, hunky dory for us? Obviously not. There are certain challenges and certain recommendations that industry has put up from time to time, and has worked closely with the government at the center, and I'm sure at the state level as well. My colleagues in Amway who look after and who work with the states, Alka Gurnani has worked with Mr. Mukesh Mishra, I believe, from time to time. Adulteration remains a big issue, which might, you know, we might bear the brunt of it, because a lot of products that we or companies like ours might make are being sold off the shelf or by sellers. And we're working very closely with FSSAI to ensure that this does not go unchecked. as we know, FSSAI has signed an MOU with the National Anti-Doping Agency, because again, supplementation plays a big role for youngsters who go into gyms and sports professionals, and a lot of it could be spiked. So there again is something that we as an industry have to be, you know, partner with the government. One area of concern for the industry is a rampant online sale of unregulated nutraceutical products. Very often we see that, you know, as with any other product, if a product is purchased by a consumer from a particular company, the accountability is very strong. But very often consumers might be tempted to go online and buy something on a huge discount. And that tends to be, you know, need not be from a particular stable as has been labeled as such. So e-commerce remains one area that needs to be, you know, addressed. And the truth is that the government is working on an e-commerce policy, taking into account a lot of these concerns. And I think what we find, having been in the market now for about 25 years plus, and more than 50% of Amway's turnover comes from the nutraceuticals, is that again, the consumer element is little, the awareness element is little low. happy to share with the esteemed panel and out here that companies like Amway, in fact, the entire direct selling industry takes a large role in terms of helping spreading the awareness. My colleagues inform me that there are more than 200,000 direct sellers in a state like Uttar Pradesh, contributing very significantly to the state socioeconomic landscape. Out of these 200,000, more than 55% would be women. So it's again a very strong kind of a medium to reach consumers and help them understand the benefits of such products. Our company itself, we conduct more than 20,000 training sessions, product training sessions in a year, so that our people are best informed when they go out and are able to answer consumers well. So I think so long as a seller takes that responsibility to ensure that in a moment, especially in a time like this, where your health is in your hands, we are there saying the right things, doing the right things with the right kind of products, working in partnership with the government where we're given the opportunity, contributing to the socioeconomic landscape of a particular state. UP is a very big state for us. The center had passed guidelines for this industry about 3 years back. We've been working very closely with the UP government. We're yet to get the guidelines in that particular state, but we are confident that with the right kind of, you know, intervention such as this, perhaps, we are able to reach across to the government and put in this small little request from our side. I think that's it from my side. I hope I've stayed within the time frame and within the...
Thank you.
Great. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mr. Banerjee. Thank you. You made a very important point that the one needs to be very cautious because there is a big volume of unregulated online trade going on. And I think that is, since the Honorable Minister is also there, I hope some steps will be taken. You see, your Amway products are known all over the world, not just in India. And I wish you had made a virtual presentation by way of a gift to all the panelists, because it would not cost anything.
That we can do now, sir.
Anyway, thank you very much for a very good presentation. And now we move over to a very eminent personality in the field of journalism, a very eminent citizen of the country, Mr. Sudhir Mishra. It is good to have views of the journalists because they are very free and frank. And they will tell us, you see, if something is wrong, they will say, this is something wrong, and that is where some steps should be taken. Now, he's got a wide experience of journalism of more than 25 years with brands like Dainik Jagran, Dainik Bhaskar, Hindustan, Navbharat Times. And he's also worked as the executive editor at Dainik Bhaskar Udaipur in Rajasthan. Currently, he's working as senior editor in Navbharat Times, handling Lucknow and NCR units. He has received fellowships for International Kaisa Health Fellowship on HIV/AIDS, first CSE Media Fellowship for South Asian region, that is climate change in South Asia, Indications, Impacts and Innovation for Survival in 2008-2009. So it's a privilege to have Mr. Sudhir Mishra to share his views with us.
Thank you, Basin ji. Namaskar.
वेलकम
एक बहुत अच्छा मंच मिला है मुझे बात करने के लिए. कुछ चीजें मैं जो सबसे इम्पोर्टेंट मुझे लग रही है बोलने के लिए वो ये कि ये महामारी आई और अचानक आई, लोगों को इतना प्रिपेयर्ड होने का, तैयार होने का मौका नहीं था. तो उसकी जो हैंडलिंग हो रही है, चाहे वो सारी हम दुनिया की बात करें या भारत की बात करें या अपने देश की बात करें, उत्तर प्रदेश की बात करें, सभी जगहों पे मुझे एक बड़ी कमी लग रही है. मैंने एक डेटा यूएस की एक एजेंसी से लिया था जिसमें डेली की जो मॉर्टेलिटी है इंडिया में वो 15,000 से 20,000 के बीच करीब थी 2 साल पहले. मतलब डेली जो डेथ्स होती थी, 2,000 डेथ्स तो डेली डायरिया से होती थी और 4,500 के करीब हार्ट अटैक से होती थी, 4,000 के करीब हाइपरटेंशन और तमाम दूसरी बीमारियों से. तो तो उसमें काफी बड़ी संख्या थी रोज मरने वालों की, करीब 15,000 से 20,000। अभी जब कोविड की डेथ्स को रिपोर्ट किया जा रहा है, चाहे वो गवर्नमेंट की एजेंसीज हो या मीडिया की हो, मीडिया ने तो उसको इतना हाइपर कर दिया है, दुनिया के मीडिया ने, खासतौर से टीवी चैनल्स ने, कि लोग इतना डर गए, सिर्फ लोग ही नहीं डर गए, मेडिकल डॉक्टर्स डर गए और पैरामेडिकल स्टाफ डर गया, लोगों ने छुट्टियां ले ली अपने यहाँ, लोगों ने काम से, काफी लोग आगे कोरोना वॉरियर के तौर पे आए हैं और काफी लोग अच्छा इलाज में लोगों के लगे हैं, लेकिन काफी असर भी पड़ा। असर ये पड़ा कि उसके जो प्रोटोकॉल्स थे वो लोगों को मालूम नहीं थे कि कैसे इलाज करना है। अब आज हाल ये कि मैं आपको आज सुबह का किस्सा बताता हूँ। एक लखनऊ के एक बहुत प्रतिष्ठित परिवार की महिला है, उन्होंने मुझे फोन किया कि सुधीर जी, मैं महानगर में रहती हूँ और मेरे घर के आसपास काफी कोरोना पॉजिटिव लोग हो गए हैं और मेरी सास ससुर बुजुर्ग हैं और मेरे घर में छोटे बच्चे भी हैं। अब मुझे, आप मेरा फोन कभी भी आए तो प्लीज जरूर उठा लीजिएगा, क्योंकि अगर किसी को होता है तो मैं सिर्फ पीजीआई लखनऊ चाहती हूँ। उनकी ये रिक्वेस्ट थी कि पीजीआई लखनऊ के अलावा वो और कहीं नहीं जाना चाहते हैं अगर उनके घर में हो। इतना डर, इतना खौफ है और इतनी विश्वास नहीं है सिस्टम के ऊपर कि बाकी अस्पतालों में भी अच्छा इलाज उनको मिल रहा है। और कोरोना को लेकर जो भ्रांति है कि कोरोना हुआ तो मतलब मर ही गए, जो ये अभी तक लोगों के बीच से अंदर से ये निकल नहीं पा रही है, उसका असर ये पड़ा है कि रिपोर्टर्स, मीडिया सबसे ज्यादा अनअवेयर है। मैं अगर मीडिया की बात करूं, मीडिया कुछ भी रिपोर्ट करे दे रहा है, कोरोना का विस्फोट हुआ, कोरोना का धमाका हुआ, कोरोना ने तांडव मचाया, जो इस तरह की इंग्लिश में और हिंदी में जो अखबारों में खबरें और मीडिया में, जो इलेक्ट्रॉनिक मीडिया में जिस तरह से आई, अखबारों में, अस्पतालों में ट्रीटमेंट बंद हो गया। नोएडा में मैं देखता हूँ, नोएडा में एक लेडी को रात में वो सरकारी एम्बुलेंस में निकली और 4 हॉस्पिटल्स में गई, उसको कहीं एडमिट नहीं किया गया और उसकी सुबह डेथ हो गई। खैर, गवर्नमेंट ने उसमें अच्छा एक्शन किया, उसमें जांच पड़ताल हो रही है और लोगों पर कार्रवाई भी हो रही है, लेकिन ये हालात बने क्यों? कहीं ना कहीं मुझे लगता है कि ये एक गड़बड़ पूरी महामारी की हैंडलिंग में हो रही है। और अब जो आने वाला वक्त है, मुझे लगता है आने वाले वक्त में एक पुराना सिस्टम हुआ था, लखनऊ में ही मैं बात करूं, एक संक्रामक रोग हॉस्पिटल होता था जिसको कि बंद कर दिया गया पिछले कुछ सालों में। अगर संक्रामक रोग हॉस्पिटल जैसी व्यवस्था हर शहर में, हर जिले में हो, तो मुझे नहीं लगता कि बाकी हॉस्पिटल्स में, प्राइवेट हॉस्पिटल्स में या गवर्नमेंट हॉस्पिटल्स में उसका बहुत ज्यादा इम्पैक्ट पड़ता। अगर एक बढ़िया संक्रामक रोग अस्पताल, अब जिस तरह से वायरस एक्टिव है और जिस तरह से और नए खतरे आ रहे हैं, मुझे लगता है कि आने वाले वक्त की जरूरत है कि हर शहर में, हर जिले में संक्रामक रोग हॉस्पिटल एक अलग से होना चाहिए, जहां पर इस तरह के जो इंफेक्शियस डिसीजेज हैं उनके इलाज की व्यवस्था हो। दूसरी मैं बात करूं कि अभी लोगों को आगे का कैसे इसके बारे में हैंडलिंग कैसे करनी चाहिए, लोगों को, गवर्नमेंट को क्या करना चाहिए और लोगों को क्या करना चाहिए। एक बात साफ हो गई है इस वायरस को लेकर, जो मुझे अब तक समझ में आया है कि जो लोग हेल्दी हैं, जिनकी इम्यूनिटी बेहतर है, उन पर इस वायरस का कोई असर नहीं है। 80% लोग, 70% लोग, मेरे जो जानने वाले पर्सनल एडमिट हुए, मैंने देखा उनके अंदर कोई सिम्टम नहीं आया, कोई लक्षण नहीं आया। लेकिन अगर आपके साथ में कोई लाइफ स्टाइल डिसीज है, सपोज कि आपको ब्लड प्रेशर है या शुगर है या इस तरह की कोई बीमारी है, तो वो उसके साथ जुड़ के बहुत खतरनाक हो रहा है वायरस। तो कहीं ना कहीं अब जो हमें, जो गवर्नमेंट को काम करना चाहिए, वो लाइफस्टाइल डिसीज के ऊपर बहुत ज्यादा ध्यान देना पड़ेगा, क्योंकि अभी तक लोग बीमारी को पालते थे, बीपी की टेबलेट खाते थे, शुगर की दवा खाते थे और साथ में मिठाइयां भी खाते थे और खूब तला भुना भी खाते थे, सारी चीजें करते रहे और सोचते थे कि हम दवा के सहारे में अपनी एक 70-80 साल की एज जी लेंगे। लेकिन ये वायरस ने बताया है कि अगर आपको आपके इस मौजूदा स्टेटस के साथ पे वायरस छूता है तो आप कैजुअलिटी की ओर जा सकते हो। तो मुझे लगता है कि कहीं ना कहीं अब नए प्रोटोकॉल्स, हेल्थ प्रोटोकॉल्स तय करने की जरूरत है, नई व्यवस्थाएं बनाने की जरूरत है। सरकार को जो अभी जो हैंडलिंग है इस समय महामारी की, उस पर तो ध्यान देना ही देना है और डेटा मैनेजमेंट पर बहुत ध्यान देना है। अगर डेटा हमारा सही हो, अगर डेटा की हमारे पास, गवर्नमेंट के पास अच्छी जानकारी हो, अगर उत्तर प्रदेश सरकार ये बता सके कि उत्तर प्रदेश में रोजाना इतने लोग मरते हैं और अभी तो उसका 1% लोग भी नहीं मर रहे हैं, तो वो लोगों के अंदर एक डर खत्म करेगी और सावधानी बरतने की केवल बात होगी। अभी क्या हो रहा है, लोग भय की वजह से सारे सिस्टम कोलैप्स किए जा रहे हैं। अभी किसी प्राइवेट हॉस्पिटल में एक कोरोना पॉजिटिव निकलता था तो उसके बाद होता है फलाना हॉस्पिटल सील कर दिया गया, फलाना हॉस्पिटल सील किया गया, अखबार में खबर छपी, और जो एक उसने अपना ब्रांड वैल्यू बनाई होती थी, एक लंबे समय तक उसने बनाई होती थी, वो दो कोरोना पॉजिटिव पेशेंट निकलने से ऐसा लगता था, बहुत सारे लोगों में मैसेज चला जाता था कि ये हॉस्पिटल बेकार है, यहाँ तो कोरोना पॉजिटिव निकल रहे हैं। तो एक प्रोटोकॉल्स होने चाहिए कि किस तरह से मीडिया ब्रीफिंग्स होंगी, किस तरह से लोगों को बताया जाएगा, और एक परमानेंट प्रोटोकॉल सरकारी हो चाहे प्राइवेट हो उसके लिए बनाना होगा कि हम कैसे कैसे देखभाल करें, कैसे संक्रमण से बचें, कैसे मतलब मास्क का जो सिस्टम हुआ है, जो हाथों में दस्ताने पहनने का सिस्टम हुआ है, या जो सैनिटाइजर यूज करने का सिस्टम हुआ है। हॉस्पिटल में बहुत लापरवाही होती है, गवर्नमेंट हॉस्पिटल्स में भी बहुत लापरवाही होती है और प्राइवेट में भी बहुत होती है। अब समय आ गया है कि बहुत ज्यादा प्रॉपर ट्रेनिंग होनी चाहिए पैरामेडिकल स्टाफ की, चाहे वो प्राइवेट सेक्टर के हो चाहे हेल्थ सेक्टर के हो, और प्रोटोकॉल्स तय होने चाहिए ताकि हमारी जो व्यवस्थाएं हैं आगे वो ठीक हो, डर लोगों में खत्म हो और सावधानी बढ़े, क्योंकि डर बहुत सारी गलत चीजें करा रहा है। डर की वजह से पूरी इकोनॉमी हमारी तहस नहस हो चुकी है। काम भी चलना चाहिए और इलाज भी लोगों को मिलना चाहिए, बस मैं इतना ही कहना चाहूंगा। धन्यवाद,
बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद, बहुत बहुत आपने इतना अच्छा बताया, एक बैलेंस्ड व्यू दिया आपने, और ये जो आमतौर पे लोग बोलते नहीं हैं वो आपने बताया कि ये जो डर है, ये खौफ है जो लोगों में, इसको किसी तरीके से दूर किया जाए, एक लोगों में भी माइंडसेट में चेंज आना चाहिए कि वो इसको एक नॉर्मल बीमारी की तरह समझें। और जैसे आपने बिल्कुल ठीक कहा कि पहले भी बीमारियों से लोग तो मरते थे, अब और काफी ज्यादा तादाद में मरते थे, तो इससे कोई कोविड का कोई ज्यादा इम्पैक्ट इतना नहीं है अभी तक,
तो ये क्यों एवरेज डेथ्स कम हो गई हैं, एवरेज डेथ्स कम हुई हैं। मैं अगर ये डेटा निकाला जाएगा तो वो कम निकलेंगे।
तो ये मतलब ये जो एक एटमोसफियर क्रिएट हुआ है डर का, खौफ का, ये हमारी इकोनॉमी के लिए भी ठीक नहीं है, क्योंकि फिर वो अगर लॉकडाउन रहेंगे या रिस्ट्रिक्शन रहेंगे तो फिर काम पे लोग कैसे जाएंगे, और बिल्कुल नहीं जाएंगे तो काम भी नहीं होगा, इकोनॉमी भी वहीं पे स्टेलमेट रहेगी। तो इसमें एक जिम्मेवारी जो है सरकार की भी होती है, और ये मेडिकल प्रोफेशन की भी होती है, और फिर लोगों की अपनी जिम्मेवारी भी होती है जो सिटीजन्स हैं, कि भी हमको अपना माइंडसेट चेंज करना है। ठीक है, ये है, कोविड है, इसको डील कर लेंगे, हम इसको करते हैं जैसे बाकी बीमारियों के इसको भी फेस करते हैं। तो ये बहुत ही अच्छा आपने बोला कि ये जो एक्सप्रेशन यूज करते हैं मीडिया वाले, मतलब आपके कुलीग जो हैं, विस्फोट और धमाका एंड ऑल दैट, ये एक लोगों में डर और खौफ क्रिएट करता है। तो हम सुनेंगे अपने मंत्री जी से भी कि उनके क्या विचार हैं इस बारे में। पर बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद, मैनी मैनी थैंक्स टू यू मिश्रा जी, थैंक यू। So, friends from now India, where we are all comfortably sitting in our offices or residence, or possibly Dr. Triyan is sitting in the hospital. Now we move to Houston, Greater Houston, and we have Mr. Jagdeep Ahluwalia. He is the founding secretary of the Indo-American Chamber of Commerce of Great Houston and currently serves as the executive director. He's done his engineer. He's an engineering graduate from the Birla Institute of Technology, and he's got 40 years of teaching, manufacturing, business management, and consulting experience. And in Houston, he is a past chair of the Mayor's International Trade Council for South Asia. He was recognized by Greater Dallas Indo-American Chamber of Commerce and honored with their Outstanding Leadership Award for his role in forming the Alliance of Indo-American Chambers in the United States. And he is so committed to promote Indo-US economic cooperation that he, at our request, decided to participate, can you imagine, at 4 a.m. in the morning. It is 4 a.m. in the morning there in Houston, and he's participating in this webinar. We indeed our great thanks, you see, gratitude to Mr. Ahluwalia. Mr. Ahluwalia, over to you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Raseen. It's always an honor and privilege to connect with ISCC India, with whom we have a very long relationship. Way back when Mr. Veeramani was the national president. So we have about 15 plus years of relationship with ISCC India. Honorable Minister Singh, Dr. Rajaraman, Dr. Basim, Ms. Rao, distinguished members of the panel, the team at ISCC India, led by Ms. Tyagi and Niluji, that put together today's webinar. Ladies and gentlemen, I bring greetings from the chairman of our board, Tarush Anand, and the members, and it is a pleasure to join you today from Houston. We have had the honor of hosting an inbound delegation led by then Western India Council President and now National President, Ms. Rajalakshmi Rao, and she has remained a constant source of support for our common agenda for promoting bilateral trade. In 2018, our delegation led by Houston Mayor Sylvester Turner met the leadership of ISCC in India and Dr. Preeta Rajaraman, and we look forward to continue to working with her. During our 2020 delegation to Delhi and Mumbai with Harris County Commissioner Adrian Garcia, we met Secretary General Kamal Vora, a friend from his days with the US Commerce Department, and Ms. Rao in Mumbai, and identified areas of common interest. The one we felt offered great potential was leveraging the Port of Houston, which is the number one US port for international tonnage. And we are going to continue a dialogue with Ms. Rao on that topic. The other was healthcare, which brings me to today's topic. I have created a slide deck to share with the panelists and attendees, and will request ISCC to forward the deck to today's attendees and panelists. I want to start off by recognizing the Chamber Board, our directors at large, and our advisors. I also want to recognize India's Consul General in Houston, Asim Mahajan, who has been driving several initiatives. Mr. Mahajan, the Consul General of India in Houston, has been driving several initiatives with India, and the Chamber is supporting all his initiatives. And healthcare is a top priority on that list. Houston is home to the world's largest medical center, the Texas Medical Center. I have a slide, the next slide, please, which focuses on Texas Medical Center. It tells you about the number of hospitals, the institutes, the medical schools, and other things. It also talks about MD Anderson Cancer Center, the Texas Heart Institute. And more importantly, it talks about TMCX, the incubator at the Texas Medical Center, which Ms. Rao and her delegation had the privilege of visiting when she came to Houston. Next slide, please. Over the year, Houston has been engaged in healthcare, starting with the initiative we took over 15 years ago when we helped MD Anderson Cancer Center connect with a similar center of excellence in India, the Tata Cancer Center. We were also responsible as a chamber for connecting Vyas Institute in Bangalore, the famous yoga institute. And because of that relationship, yoga has become a subject of research in the treatment of cancer and has become part of the healing process. More recently, our founding president, Dr. Durga Garwal, was responsible by meeting Prime Minister Modi to convince India to consider starting a doctor of nursing practice, which will help ease the burden on our medical professionals in India. In the new normal, we are hosting a series of webinars featuring some of America's top healthcare leaders. All the recordings for these events are available on our website, and we invite your audience to log on to the Chamber website and download these recordings. In today's presentation, I want to showcase four of our member companies. The first one is Fanon Innovation Studio. Next slide, please. Which is a unique incubator led by past president Atul Bharadacharya, which is at the cutting edge of bringing in research scientists and helping them develop their potential by helping look after the business side and letting them look after the development of their products and services. This slide will be shared, and it is a potential opportunity for anybody who would like to leverage some of the research coming out of TMCX and monetizing it by setting up a project or a business in Houston. The next slide, please, focuses on UNCH Labs, which was set up by one of our directors at large, a long-term Houston resident, who is a scientist known for his advanced research and very well respected in the community. We are very privileged that he has created an antibody test for COVID-19, which we feel is as good as the one that has been created by the majors like Abbott Labs. He's the homegrown Indo-American scientist from our neighborhood, and we would like to connect him through ISCC India with the government of Uttar Pradesh, with the hospital systems in India, to see if there is a potential of his tests being used by you in India. Next slide, please. I also want to showcase Phoenix Healthcare Solutions, owned by a Houston native, who has set up operations in India. They are making world-class products like lancets and swabs used in the diabetes treatment. And their products are packaged and exported and sold all over the world, including in the USA, as brands that we recognize. And the last of the companies I want to showcase is OcuSoft. Next slide, please. Can you move to the next slide? Yeah, OcuSoft is an example of a pharma company. They make eye care products, drops, and other products. And these are the kind of opportunities that Houston offers for companies in India, for businessmen in India, to look at, to set up partnerships, to share technology. Can we move on to the last slide, please? In the interest of time, I just want to end by stating that the Consul General of India in Houston, Asim Mahajan, and the Chamber are working very collaboratively. And we are looking at exploring, promoting collaborations between India and the USA in the field of medical devices, pharmaceuticals, healthcare, life science research, nursing. We are looking at working together in the startup ecosystem and in digital health, with telemedicine being the new frontier. There is a lot of potential for joint projects, leveraging some of the top leadership in both our countries. ISCCGH is available to continue to work with you in creating and identifying bilateral opportunities in healthcare. And the last slide has my email and my cell number. With that, I want to thank ISCC India for giving us this opportunity to partner with you, and we look forward to a much a continued meaningful relationship. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Ahluwalia. That was a brilliant presentation. And I'm sure with the Honorable Minister hearing what you said, we know that Houston can offer great opportunities for the US companies from Houston to invest in India, in the state of Uttar Pradesh and other areas, and a greater coordination and better ties are required to be developed between India and Houston in the field of healthcare. I think your presentation was very helpful, and any proposals or suggestions coming from your member companies of your Indo-American Chamber of Greater Houston, you may please forward them to us so that we can take it up with the government of Uttar Pradesh through the good offices of the Honorable Minister and the Secretary. Thank you very much once again. Thank you. Thank you. And friends, we had this participation at 4 a.m. Houston time from Mr. Ahluwalia, but now we have another presentation from the United States, but the base is New Delhi, and the base is the U.S. Embassy in India. And the representative is no less a person than Dr. Preetha Rajaraman. She is the health attaché and South Asia regional representative for the US government of Health and Human Services, that is the HHS, and serves as a key advisor to the US Secretary of Health and Human Services and the US Embassy in India on matters involving health and biomedical research in South Asia. She is responsible for in-country representation, monitoring and coordination of the policy, programs, and interests of all HHS agencies, including the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. She received the Director's Award for Exceptional Leadership, fostering cooperation in cancer research between scientists in the United States and India. Her research on the interaction between genetic susceptibility and environmental factors in cancer has resulted in over 130 peer-reviewed publications. She is an expert advisory member for various international bodies, including International Commission on Radiation Protection, the World Health Organization, and so on. So, over to you, Dr. Preetha Rajaraman. It's a privilege for us to have you with us today, this afternoon. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Basin, and to our IACC colleagues for inviting me to this this excellent panel. I've really enjoyed listening to the panelists so far, and I'm sure I'll enjoy the ones coming shortly afterwards. So what we have today is a situation that is so unusual in that no matter who we are, no matter where we are in the world, we're all facing a common challenge for which we have no preset solutions. As of this morning, we know that there were more than 11.6 million confirmed cases of COVID-19. And we also know that two of the countries that are facing this the most at the moment are the US and India. And so one of the things really that we've heard some of our speakers say before is, yes, of course, we have the challenge, but we also have the hope. And what I'd like to concentrate a little bit on is the fact that we have mutual strengths that we can bring to the table. As we face this global threat, we are also committed to finding joint solutions. And in fact, if you look at our ability to find these joint solutions, they build on the fact that we as countries have a very long history in collaboration in health, spanning several different fields within health and several decades. And you've already mentioned some of the agencies that have been working here for a long time, including the CDC, NIH, and FDA. But some of the topics that have come up already in terms of vaccines, joint work on vaccines, mental health, digital health, research and development, strengthening of regulation for drugs and devices, all of these are areas that we actually have a long history working in. So in fact, our investment over the last few decades has really been paying off as we think about how do we tackle this new challenge that we're jointly facing. So some of your members may already be aware actually of one of our longest biomedical research partnerships, which is known as the Indo-US Vaccine Action Program. And this is a 33-year-old collaboration between the US National Institutes of Health and the Indian Department of Biology, as well as the Indian Council of Medical Research. But in addition, we've had many, many private partners from both the US and India be a part of this initiative, as you would have to be for vaccine development. And certainly one of the biggest success stories out of this was the joint development of the first indigenous vaccine for rotavirus. You know, through the vaccine program, I think we still continue to work on a range of infectious diseases, but relevant to what we're looking at right now One of the things that we are specifically looking at is how can we work together on the development of a vaccine that would be effective against COVID-19. Many of you also probably have worked with our Food and Drug Administration, and of course, it has been working closely with the Government of India counterparts to ensure that the safety, quality, and effectiveness of both food and medical products that come into the US are top-notch. And indeed, if you look at why is this important, in fact, India is number two in terms of import lines for drugs, number seven for food into the US. So this is a really important relationship. And again, when we look at this through the COVID lens, with the development of new devices, new drugs, new treatments, certainly we will be hoping to work very closely with our counterparts here and with industry both here in the US to try and bring these to market. And finally, of course, I'd be remiss if I didn't mention the work of our Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, who many of you know as our premier public health agency in the US. And CDC has spent many decades in India engaging in joint work to create systems that basically prevent, detect, and respond to diseases. So, of course, since January of this year, this agency has been very active in India, working closely with our partners here to help strengthen laboratories in India, improving the skills and knowledge of health workers on the front lines of the epidemic, focusing on infection prevention control, and also talking about risk communications. And in fact, in addition to all of this continued technical assistance for COVID-19 specifically, CDC has also committed an additional $5 million in funds above and beyond some of the reprogramming of an additional $4 million for COVID response specifically in these areas, surveillance, contact tracing, infection prevention control, and so on. And one of the things that I would like to mention is all of this collaboration has commitment at the very highest level. So during the earlier visit this year, which seems like a lifetime ago already in February, when President Trump visited India, in fact, two new MOUs were signed in health, one on medical products with the FDA, the other on mental health. And in fact, I saw that one of the participants on the call specifically asked about mental health and COVID, which I think is a very important question because this has created such a new ecosystem for us, something so unfamiliar. And we are seeing that one of the challenges that is coming up long term is the mental health effects of the isolation, of the stigma, and so on. One of the areas that was highlighted in the joint statement was the need to work together for the prevention and detection of outbreaks. Who would have thought that that would really become something that was so relevant to us today? So I'll just end by saying that, you know, we move on very positively because we do believe that between our nations, we do have the capacity to find solutions that will work not only for the US and India, but really hopefully globally as well. And we invite all of you to be partners with us on this journey. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Peter Rajaraman. I think it was a brilliant presentation. The US and India are the two greatest democracies in the world. And we have stood together during all times, fighting for liberty, fighting for human rights, and against terrorism. Now, this is also a fight virtually against an act of terrorism. We don't know who has created it, but I think that has to be faced very boldly. And the two countries are well placed to join hands, that is US and India, to fight this menace, you see, which has come. I like your slogan that yes, we have challenges, but we have hope also. I think so long as our cooperation is there and we are able to develop some vaccines, as you said, there is a program going on, joint solutions, and there is a private sector partnership also. For that, we will hear more from our expert, Dr. Naresh Trehan also. But I think it is a brilliant initiative and it's very encouraging and heartening to see the approach of the US government and the US embassy in India, such a supportive role so far as India is concerned. And I can assure you that this is mutual. Whatever we can do from India, we'll continue to do. Once again, our thanks to you and our greetings to the US embassy here. Thank you very much. And friends, now we move on to someone who is really and closely connected with the entire healthcare sector. It is not just the COVID. And that is none other than Dr. Naresh Trehan, who is a renowned cardiovascular and cardiothoracic surgeon, a graduate from the King George Medical College, and who practiced at New York University Medical Center, Manhattan, from 1971 to 1988. Dr. Trehan is the chairman and managing director and the chief cardiac surgeon at Medanta, the Medicity, a 1,500-bedded multi-super specialty institute, which offers cutting-edge technology and state-of-art treatment facilities at an affordable cost. That is important, affordable cost. The institute is governed under the guiding principles of providing medical services to patients with care, compassion, and commitment. That is also reflected when Dr. Trehan set up his facility, a big medical facility in Uttar Pradesh, in the city of Lucknow. I think that is a great service to that great state of this country. And he founded the Escorts Heart Institute and Research Center, where he was the executive director. And the entire institute was conceptualized, created, and managed by Dr. Trehan. Dr. Trehan has received many prestigious awards as an acknowledgement of the great role that he has played in medical healthcare, Padma Shri, and then the Padma Bhushan Award presented by the Government of India. And he has received honorary doctorate degrees from 3 prestigious international universities. So, over to you, Dr. Naresh Trehan.
Good evening, Lalit, and thank you for inviting me. It has been a pleasure that we have the minister, health minister from UP, which I call my professional birthplace, because I went to King George's Medical College, and you mentioned the hospital in Lucknow. That was a 40-year-old commitment that when I become something, I will bring something to Lucknow as the best medical care. So it's now open and doing a great job. So I am very thankful to the government of UP, to the minister, to the chief minister, that they have always been very supportive of actually making it happen and move forward, and we can continue to do what we established as the finest medical center over there. SGPGI, as somebody said, is already fantastic. So things are moving in UP also, and hopefully, Asan had said about Varanasi, my next move is Varanasi. So, Asan, we should create a Medanta there also in the coming years. Coming back to COVID,
looking forward,
current times are, like you said, scary. Everybody is scared, including us. The scare comes from 2 things. One is the fact that this little bugger, if may I call it, has really shaken the whole world together. You could have regional problem, somebody got hit by malaria, somebody with something else, but this has shaken the whole world. And that by itself, if it was not enough, the point is we understand it very little. Every day, new information comes up. So if you started 3 months, 4 months ago, till 6 weeks ago, we actually not even understood the pathophysiology of how it attacks the body. Then, of course, we were of this view that it multiplies in the upper airways, goes down, destroys the lungs, you get die of lack of oxygen. That was the first thought. Then, of course, we learned it affects other organs also and stuff like that. But the key to the understanding came, the mechanism of death came from the 50 autopsies. The Italian doctors in Bergamo, against the advice of WHO, they conducted 50 consecutive autopsies, which showed that the real mechanism of death was uncontrolled inflammation, along with what the damage the virus was doing in the body's attempt to fight it was creating such a huge storm, which we call cytokine storm, that was actually inflaming the arteries also, and the blood clotted in them so that oxygen could not transfer from the lungs into the arteries. And that's what the mechanism, ultimate mechanism of death was. So as we go along, our understanding improves, and so does our ability to treat, not cure, but treat. So having started with hydroxychloroquine as one of the repurposed drugs, because we know that it had some antiviral activity in our usage, which has been here for decades in India. From then to the race of trying to find an antiviral against COVID-19, and that way remdesivir and favipravir were the two drugs that were being that were the lead candidates. Remdesivir from America, and that also comes back to the fact that there is so much cooperation that the Gilead company voluntarily licensed 4 companies in India to go ahead and manufacture remdesivir on ASAP basis, so that millions and millions of doses would be available to our population, because it was shown in the initial studies that if used in time, it actually shortened the length of the suffering from 11 to 4 to 5 days, 6 days. So it almost halved, and consequently also saved many lives. So this to and fro between America and India on this whole basis of science exchange is also a very important factor in our relationship. So as was said by Dr. Basin, that I am a product of New York University Medical Center. It's a medical school. I trained there for heart surgery. Fortunate enough, one of the greatest teachers was there, Dr. Frank Spencer. And then I came back after 18 years. I had already established Heart Institute. So I can say downstream in my life, I have gained from my education in the U.S., in my relationships with the U.S., and continuous progression in trying to find newer and newer solutions as together with them in the field of medicine and heart disease. So this relationship, of course, cannot be underscored. And I'm glad that I'm part of this whole interaction, which is Indo-American Chamber of Commerce, which is nice. And I have all the good things that I've heard from our friends in Houston at 4 a.m. in the morning, with such enthusiasm to offer relationships, collaborations. This was fantastic. But now, where do we go from here is the big question. So, first, we don't know what's going to happen, like you said, Mr. Hassan. The green shoots that we see are that there are some signs that like Mumbai and Delhi are beginning to show some decrease in the infection rate. It is also showing 85% plus infections are mild. That means more and more people can be treated at home in isolation, and fewer people will require hospitalization and even less requiring ventilators. So this is a good sign, because we are part of it. we see it from the private providers also, that this is universally happening in these two areas where we were the first ones to get affected. Now, of course, another thing is that Tamil Nadu and other places are on fire, and that's why the numbers are still exponentially going up. But amazingly, for whatever reason, and it's very difficult to hide deaths, I think, that the number of deaths in India are still on the lower side of the spectrum, which is a good thing. Now, we know the four stages of the disease. We know how to try to intervene at every stage so that people don't get desperately ill and have to go on a ventilator and then not recover from there. So I think over a period of time, our anxiety about not surviving an attack from COVID has gone down. Yes, older people, I'm one of them, still has, and if you have comorbidities, yes, it has a problem. And now I also would take this opportunity to compliment our Honorable Minister and the Chief Minister of UP, how well, from the very early days, they have seriously taken this whole epidemic or pandemic now and done contact tracing, isolation, all that stuff. So today, we are looking at UP as one of the best results that in the states that you can find now. The only thing, ministers, are that the basic thing is we still can't be complacent because there are so much confusion of how it may come back, in whatever form it may come back. There is mutation being detected around the world. So we still have to be very alert. So I always object to the fact that some people say, oh, it's going to stay here, so learn to live with it. I don't think we should learn to live with it. Learn to live with it would mean that you are accepting it. And I don't think we should accept the fact that this is a dangerous fellow. What we need to learn is to how to cope with it for long periods of time and not let two things happen. One, if we let our guard down, and it is well established and even reinforced recently by 232 scientists from around the world, that it's airborne. Okay, airborne means we always knew it was airborne, but is it even more dangerous that smaller particles can also carry enough virus to infect people? So, if we don't let our guard down, we try to go back to work, I still go to work every day. The basic thing is that whatever you can do from those three mantras to protect yourself, you need to do that. You may still get it. One, if person gets it, we still have, and we detect it early, we can still make a big difference today than we could before. So we have ways of diagnosing the serious ones. We know how to intervene early. We have favipravir, remdesivir, hydroxychloroquine. We have betamethasone. We have PCZ. All these things in a sequence has changed the course of the disease in many, many, many people. So on one hand, we can look forward to the fact that we will be able to fight it. Second, with great expectation, the vaccine, where also there is a lot of cooperation between the American companies and Indian companies, and India does have the capacity to manufacture. The biggest manufacturing facility for vaccines are in India. So that will also be a great cooperation going forward. And more importantly, how do we bring the economics and the commerce back? So I think if we seriously create a model of safety for every business line, industry, profession, how they can keep themselves safer, I think that's the best we can do. It will still run through society, but hopefully in a much milder form. So with that, I say Indo-US relationship in medicine, healthcare, and other things also is only getting deeper. Lalit mentioned who created this virus. I think it is becoming more and more apparent that it was you can't find the right word without getting abusive, of this Chinese menace has been a big problem. And not only did it end with corona, it is going ahead with many other things. So I think that we need to really strengthen the same minds around the world. We need to come together to fight this menace and other menaces that may be created by irresponsible people. So with that, my respect to the minister and all the eminent speakers who have added a lot of life to this whole webinar and learned a lot. And I hope we'll continue to engage in some of the things moving forward, including the offer from Texas, from Houston. And we have our local Dr. Rajaraman who's here. We shall connect and try to take things even in more intense form, because we are doing a lot of work on TV along with USAID and all that. So we shall bring it to your attention what's going on at that level. Thank you very much. Appreciate your inviting me and putting me together with my friend, now the president of AI, the Indo-American Chambers, Dr. Rao. So thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Trehan. I don't know whether you are entitled or you feel better informed, but definitely I think we are all better informed after your very able and brilliant exposition about the do's and don'ts, about the fears and hopes, about the need to have better Indo-US cooperation. You are an example of Indo-US cooperation because you studied also in India and in the US where you specialized, and then you have been traveling, you see, frequently between India and US, and you have set up really a great center of healthcare, not just in Gurgaon, Medicity, but also in Lucknow. And it's very heartening to note that you also propose to set up a center in Varanasi. I think that is a good news for the state of Uttar Pradesh, as also for the country. And you also highlighted the need of scientific exchange between US and India. And the good signs you pointed out, that there is anxiety of not surviving is gradually receding. But you very rightly highlighted that we need to be vigilant so that if there is a second wave, you know, of this thing which comes, then how do we cope up with that? I think that's a very important observation, and we are sure that the Honorable Minister here will also be able to touch upon it. So with that, many thanks for participating, taking your time out. I can see you are still in your surgeons, you see, robes, and I think some surgery must be awaiting you, but please be with us till the time the Honorable Minister, you see, finishes his address. Now, I have indeed the greatest pleasure in welcoming our chief guest today, no other person than Shri Jai Pratap Singh, Honorable Cabinet Minister, Medical and Health, Family Welfare, Maternal and Child Welfare Department of the Government of Uttar Pradesh, under the able leadership of the Chief Minister of that state. Seven times that the Honorable Minister has been elected as a member of the Uttar Pradesh Legislative Assembly. And I think that's a brilliant record showing his service to the state, service to the people of Uttar Pradesh. Seven times from Bansi constituency in Siddharth Nagar district of Uttar Pradesh. And he studied in Mayo College in Ajmer in 1970 and graduated with Bachelor's of Arts honors from KC College, Bombay, a very prestigious and well-known institution. I have visited that institution as a guest lecturer so many times. It's indeed good to know that the Honorable Minister got his graduation from that college. And he's essentially a farmer by profession and is a resident of Raj Mahal, Bansi in Siddharth Nagar district. And of course, he's a politician, a political person, but more importantly, he's a public servant, a person who is serving the society at large and the people of Uttar Pradesh. Over to you, Honorable Minister Shri Jai Pratap Singh Ji.
Thank you, Dr. Lalit Vaseen. I did not know that you're going to be pre-profiling me as to, and to let everybody know my background also. I am basically a simple politician which of the party which has come to power in Uttar Pradesh in 2017. And I was given certain responsibilities in a previous department and then shifted over to this department just about 10 months ago. And of course, as I went into this department, straight away, another 2-3 months later, we went into Corona. So it's been a total turmoil for me. My earlier department was excise, which I'm sure everybody on the panel should be knowing what excise is about. It's basically about controlling and distribution of liquor. That was quite an interesting department for me. But now it is a totally different sort of a ball game as far as this Corona is concerned. And I'm thankful to you and to all, first of all, I must say good afternoon to all the panel members, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you to everyone for inviting me onto the Indo-American Chamber of Commerce and giving me an opportunity to say a few words in front of such eminent and prominent leaders of the society. And it's a great honor for me to be in front of you because I really don't know how much my, what I can contribute to this entire debate or rather this discussion on COVID-19, where we have such an eminent doctor as Dr. Naresh Chauhan, who knows everything about all this and everyone else knows about it also. So being a politician and being in the health department, and to try and sound as a, not as a politician, but more as a semi-doctor, or rather as somebody who knows a little bit of his department, I will try and give you a small insight of Uttar Pradesh. Firstly, we are very lucky that when we came to power in 2017, our Chief Minister Yogi Adityanath, who'd been a 5-term MP earlier, had battled out in his eastern UP area where we come from also against a big problem of Japanese encephalitis and AES. Now these two diseases were such a disease that we had from 1,000 to 1,500 deaths of children every year in Gorakhpur. And it was a big shame to our country and to our state where we were not being able to control it. When he became the Chief Minister, we started working on this entire issue and we laid out a program in which we ensured that each family in 38 districts were inoculated by a vaccine against Japanese encephalitis, and we coordinated all the departments in UP in the 38 districts. And we did 100% vaccination, and we brought down the death from 1,500 or 1,200 down to only nine in the last year. So it was a big achievement for us till the time we were handling this. Now, when we came into Corona or COVID-19, as Dr. Naresh said, that it is something which we don't even know what it is. It's a virus which has come in from China and moved along the whole of the Western Europe and America and everywhere, and finally landed up in India. And it had to, because it's going across the entire world. So UP, as we are health department, it's huge. We've got a huge infrastructure. And more or less, UP is always known as the worst state, managed state, where people think, there's such a big health department, which doesn't do anything. We've got bad hospitals. We doctors don't have any love lost for their patients. They don't attend their duties. Whole lot of problems we've had. And this is what everybody talks about Uttar Pradesh. But when the Chief Minister came in and he started tightening everything and created a system out of this, and the best opportunity we got was COVID-19. The moment we got the alert of COVID-19 somewhere around the 25th of January by the Ministry of Health, Uttar Pradesh, we went into a proactive drive, and Uttar Pradesh and Nepal has 19 entry points. Straight away, we started training our doctors and we started putting a process process in on those borders, where doctors started verifying the taking notes and verifying the foreigners who started coming in from those points, and noting down, and just basically with basic equipment like just a thermometer. We didn't have infrared thermometer those days, but just a thermometer and getting to know what the thing is, because we were also not very clear what exactly COVID is. So basic ailments of the foreigner, and to try and find out what exactly he has when he comes into, and where he's come from, his mobile number, and where he's going to. All those details we started noting down from that day one only. Thereafter, the chief minister started creating, or we all started creating, isolation beds in all the district hospitals. We did all that also, and that wasn't very much. That was just about maybe about 10,000 in about 75 districts of UP. So we did all that. And thereafter, once we started seeing the reports coming gradually from the south and coming into the whole of India, Uttar Pradesh went into a sort of highly active system, where our first case came into Agra on the 8th of March. And that time, in King George Medical University, we had one lab which was taking out results of about 200 to 300, but which had to be confirmed by the NIV Pune. So with that system, we started with the first case in Agra, and gradually at that time only, the chief minister ensured that we start increasing our lab capacity, our testing capacity. So we went into overdrive, and the net result was from March 8th, where we were testing only 200 to 300 cases. Today we have 25 labs, and today we are testing, as of today, 30,000 plus tests per day we are doing. We are doing antigen tests also. We are doing TrueNet tests also, which we put into each and every government hospital, so that the doctors are able to identify the patients and then treat them accordingly, the non-COVID treatment. And along with that, a pool testing, which we initiated over here with the help of KGMU and other departments. So overall, we are doing almost about 30 to 32,000 testing per day, which was the most important part of our thing. Now, during the time when the COVID first came into UP in March itself, we had the first lot which was coming in through the travel, through travelers who came from foreign countries, from Italy, from Spain, from America, from London, from wherever. There was a lot of travel history, and there were a lot of cases gradually coming in. That was easily controllable. Second wave came in through that, through a community which had apparently come in from other parts of the world, who had congregated in Delhi. And there was a huge amount of influx of positive cases coming from that side. So that also took us a little bit of time to settle everything. And now the third, which came in, which has started coming in, that Uttar Pradesh has got, we have taken in 38 lakhs of migrant laborers. We have 32 lakhs which are recorded with each and every mobile number, their address, their village, their district. And another, which we envisage, is another 5 to 6 lakhs, which we know had come in earlier through various means. So we have taken in about 38 lakhs of migrant laborers from the 1st of May onwards, or a little earlier also. The amount of trains which were coming in, our entire medical setups were there from the station to the screening facilities at each and every entry point into a district. We had a huge number of teams where we integrated all sorts of departments. We had the Ayurvedic department, we had our own department, we had administrative people coming in, and each and every person was screened and continued to be screening till the time he went into his home. Anybody who seemed to be not having any sort of symptoms were just put into their home and told to be there for the next 21 days at that time. And that was monitored by our field workers, who we call ASHA workers, who have done a tremendous job and are still doing a tremendous job identifying people in the villages also. So this was the entire concept of how we worked very fast with the initiative taken by the chief minister. And at the same time, we managed to arrange for 1,51,000 beds in case it is required in the state of UP. All over the 75 districts, we have made enough arrangements for any number of patients, at least up to 1,51,000, where we'll ensure that they'll have oxygen cylinders also, and to a certain amount, ventilators also, when it comes to that requirement. So then we initiated the form of L1, L2, and L3. L3 is what we call our medical colleges, which is a tertiary care, and take care of certain comorbid patients, where we did have a lot of number of deaths, and we're still having deaths there also. But now we're trying to control that also. So this is the basic system which we generated with the initiative of the Chief Minister, who was continuously pushing us to upgrade our facility to whatever possibility till today. And just in about a 2 minutes, something I'll just give you some more information, is that for the future, we've already decided to have every medical college which we have, the government medical college, which is about 29 in number, each one will have a RT-PCR lab, which will start working within the next 10, 15 days, or maybe in a month's time, after the 25, which we already initiated. And at our hospital level, we have district hospital levels. We have 7 district hospitals, which we've already initiated the process of establishing RT-PCR in these hospitals also. And they will also have other machines, which will also see other types of diseases which we deal with for assessing those sort of diseases also. So, and for the future, in league with the central government, we are putting a proposal for at least 100, almost in every district hospital, at a vector-borne disease unit, where we'll have a whole lab, which will have all sorts of machines for all sorts of diseases, and about 100 beds, which we're going to have for these, especially for these sort of diseases. Because in Uttar Pradesh, what happens is, today we are fighting corona. Already we've started going into the Japanese encephalitis cases, which have started now. A little later, we'll be going into dengue. We already have a certain amount of districts which are affected by Kala Azar, which is on the Bihar and Eastern UP border. Then we go in for chikungunya. Then we go into swine flu. We have programs for TB. We have programs for filaria. We have programs for malaria. So with this entire thing which is there, we have set programs for each and every disease right from January to December continuously, where our training is continuously done, where our field workers are already in place. And now with corona already in this entire setup, so we are doing the same amount of inspection and same amount of screening for corona today by these field workers, where they are going to each and every home today. And we are identifying diseases like ILI, I think you must be all knowing ILI and SARDI, which is influenza-like illness, and severe, what do you call, acute respiratory system. These two illnesses, which apparently convert into COVID-19, we are identifying these patients in the villages, house to house, and getting them out from there and putting them into the hospital and treating them separately. And also, we are making a database of all people in the villages and in every home who have who are already having problems with other illnesses like cancer from heart or kidney, liver, any other problem, comorbid, which we call, and which with the immune system being a little low, can be affected. They can be affected by COVID. So these patients are also being identified. We are having a huge database being made for them, where we'll have a caller, we have a call system where we will keep in touch with them. If they have any some sort of a symptom which they have of COVID, we'll pick them up and put them into hospital and start treating them, basically to reduce the death rate also. So in short, our testing capacity has gone up to 30 to 32,000 per day. We are doing villages house to house. We are doing colonies in big cities like all the NCR areas, antigen testing, pool testing, every type of testing which is possible, and under the guidance of ICMR, we're doing all that which is possible to ensure that the maximum amount of cases which come up, we put them into hospitals, we treat them according to their symptoms. If they are asymptomatic, if they are symptomatic, L1, L2, L3, and ensure that each and every positive case is identified, as well as the death which takes place in any hospital, whether it's a medical college or whether it's in one of our own hospitals, we ensure that is also recorded and put into a portal. So I've tried to give you a picture of what Uttar Pradesh today is under the guidance of our Chief Minister Yogi Adityanath, who has been tirelessly working 24 hours to ensure this entire system works. We all work under him and we take advice from him. And then we have put this system in place. And of course, now whatever Dr. Trehan has told us about this disease, we just wait for ICMR or whatever clinical trials, as what we hear from various news reports and all that. If it takes place and when the vaccine comes, we will be ready for that. But I can assure everybody on the panel that Uttar Pradesh, because we have a long history of combating various diseases, so our system is very much in place, and we are confident no matter how many cases come out, we don't have to worry about anything. Our doctors work overtime, our paramedics, our nurses, our ward boys, and our ASHA workers who are in the field continuously day in and day out. The amount of information which we get is what we take care of. So I think this is more than what I can speak for in front of such eminent and honorable people over here, because I'm not qualified to be saying so many things, but I've tried to give my best of Uttar Pradesh and whatever our health department can do. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Fantastic.
Thank you, Honorable Minister. Thank you very much. I think you spoke from your heart, and it was the figures which you gave, they are all real bona fide figures. And that is why Yogi Adityanath ji has reposed such great confidence in your good self to head this very important health department, you see, in the ministry. You have highlighted that you have a very huge infrastructure and a very good effective health department. But more importantly, the government of Uttar Pradesh, under your stewardship in this department, took immediate steps to take to control the COVID, and 30,000 tests have been conducted per day. More importantly, the effective treatment is being given, you see, to the COVID patients, so that the number of deaths are reduced to the minimum. But I think what you did for the migrant laborers, I think, is exemplary. I think state of Uttar Pradesh should act like a role model in dealing with about 38 lakhs of migrant laborers, which could have, you see, been a very big threat in view of the COVID menace which exists there. But I think that was handled very, very effectively and without much misery, you see, or discomfort to the migrant labor. It's very heartening to note that systems are very much in place in the state of Uttar Pradesh, because Uttar Pradesh has always led the country in putting, you see, affairs in place. And I'm sure that this will be followed by other states also. And the ASHA workers to whom you referred, I think they are doing a very, very commendable job. And your efforts in providing 1,51,000 beds with complete oxygen facilities, I think it is remarkable. It's a big contribution by the state of Uttar Pradesh so far as the health is concerned, whether it is mental health, because if there is no coronavirus, the mental health will also improve automatically. So we are very grateful to you. And I'm sure that under your guidance, under your stewardship, effective steps will be taken in consultation with the medical profession, such as persons like Dr. Naresh Trehan. And also, we can get great assistance from the US Embassy. And if we can be helpful in being the channel for that, we'll be very glad to do that. And I'm sure that I can see Preeta Rajaraman, you see, listening to that. And all the cooperation will come from the US Embassy. And so far as US companies are concerned, make investments in India in the field of healthcare, we have a big assurance, you see, coming from our Houston representative, Mr. Ahluwalia. So I'm sure that the government of Uttar Pradesh will take benefit, you see, of these offers which have come so far as the healthcare and also resultant economic revival is concerned, which has had some setback. So thanks once again to all the panelists. And now I request Mr. Mukesh Bahadur Singh, who has been the convener of this webinar, a very important member of our Indo-American Chamber of Commerce. He's managing director of A&A Builds Projects Private Limited. So over to you, Mukesh Bahadur Singh ji, for your vote of thanks.
Thank you, Dr. Basin. Thank you, Dr. Basin. Again, a great moderation by you, as always, for such an important subject. Thank you, Shri Jaypratap Singh ji. Jaisa ki aapne pehle hi kaha, you have totally changed the complete face of the health department under the leadership of Yogi Adityanath ji. Thank you so much for sparing your valuable time. Thank you, Preetha Raja Raman ji, for your valuable insight. Thank you, Dr. Trehan. Dr. Trehan has already announced for opening up a center in Varanasi. Thank you so much, Dr. Trehan. Thank you, Jagdeep Aulia ji. I am assuring you, under the leadership of Dr. Basin and Raj Lakshmi Rao ji, certainly we will take up your offerings with Jaypratap ji. Thank you, Rajat ji. Thank you, Ehsan Khan ji, my colleague. Thank you, Sudhir Mishra ji. Sudhir Mishra ji is a very great journalist, and he has been very closely watching the COVID-19 impact with the community spread. So thank you, Sudhir Mishra ji. Thank you so much. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Preetha Ravan ji. Thank you, Secretariat. Thank you, Dr. Basin.
Thank you.
Thank you, Raj Lakshmi Rao ji. Thank you so much.
We have to first give a big clap to our Honorable Minister for giving such a fantastic deliberations today.
Thank you.